The history of math is our intellectual foundation to understanding science. Science. Beautiful, awesome, wonderful science. It's the creative foundation to our ineffable future. Hi, I'm Gabrielle Burchak, and this is my podcast, Math, Science, History. This podcast is sustained through your generous contributions, which I am so very grateful for. You can visit me at mathsciencehistory.com. Click on that coffee cup on the right side of my website and buy me a cup of coffee, or two, or three, or four, because every cup of coffee that you buy keeps this podcast up and running. Agree to disagree. Sometimes it is this agreement that holds an unexpected friendship together. Such was the case between two great philosophers, Plato and Archytas. Plato was born around 428 BCE in ancient Greece. He was the child of an aristocrat, yet his father claimed to have been a descendant of Codrus, the semi-mythical king of Athens, who was a descendant of Poseidon. Plato was instructed in grammar, music, and gymnastics, and even might have been a wrestler. He was a dedicated student of philosophy and a devoted student of Socrates. The Socratic method enthused Plato's logic and exposition, which contributed to Euclid's axiomatic deductive proofs. But Plato wanted to motivate the Athenians to understand the value of justice by defending Socrates as the gadfly of the state. After Socrates' death, Plato left Athens and traveled to southern Italy and Egypt. During his travels, he sought out the acquaintances of the Pythagoreans. Utilizing Socrates' methodology of persistent questioning, he found mathematical inspiration in the Pythagorean science of numbers. In 387 BCE, around the time that Athens began to enter into a new era of intellectualism, Plato returned to Athens. Back in Athens, Plato started a school where he taught other great thinkers and mathematicians, including Aristotle and Eudoxus of Cnidus. Plato's mathematical teachings focused on proofs that use precise descriptions, accurate and coherent assumptions, and specifically, logic in the evidence. Plato's logical process of proofs was groundbreaking to geometry. Archytas was also born around 428 BCE. There are no specific years for both Archytas and Plato, so it is debated as to who is the older philosopher in this friendship. Archytas lived for about 80 years and built a legacy of respect as a Pythagorean philosopher, philanthropist, public official, educator, mathematician, and general. His notoriety as a general was so well received that he was elected 7 consecutive years in a row. His teacher, Philalus, taught him Pythagoras' belief that mathematics is the path to know all things. Hence, Archytas was a Pythagorean, and his mathematical theories were foundational to projective geometry and number theory. Around 335 BCE, Eudemus of Rhodes, one of the world's first science historians, wrote that Archytas, quote, enriched the science with original theorems and gave it a sound arrangement, unquote. Archytas was a polymath who studied and was fascinated with many subjects. He gathered many of his studies under one belief, which was that mathematics consisted of 4 branches: arithmetic, astronomy, geometry, and music. By the Middle Ages, these 4 branches came to be known as the quadrivium. The quadrivium were 4 of the 7 liberal arts taught after the trivium, which were grammar, logic, and rhetoric. Unlike the mathematicians before Archytas, who were mathematical theorists, Archytas used mechanics to describe geometry. He was basically one of our first mechanical engineers. Around 388 BCE, Plato had left Athens after the death of his dear teacher and friend Socrates. From Athens, Plato traveled to southern Italy and then to the island of Sicily. It was his first time there. Since Plato was developing an interest in mathematics, he was intent on meeting the mathematician Archytas. By the time Plato reached Sicily, he had the opportunity to meet Archytas. Thus, they began a working relationship, which became a friendship, which ultimately saved Plato's life. But more on this later. Plato did not fully agree with Archytas's mathematical methods and distanced himself from the school of the Pythagoreans. Nevertheless, Archytas's mathematics had a considerable influence on Plato. In Plato's Book 8 of the Republic, which tells the allegory of the cave, Plato writes that, quote, "As the eyes are framed for astronomy, so the ears are framed for the movements of harmony, and these are in some sort kindred sciences, as the Pythagoreans affirm and we admit," unquote. Around the time that the two had met, a math puzzle was buzzing around philosophical circles that involved doubling the cube. In trying to solve this math puzzle, Hippocrates of Chios, a much older contemporary of Plato and Archytas, simplified the duplication of the cube by finding two mean proportionals in continued proportion. As a result, he found the cube root of 2. After this discovery, the Delian problem became a problem of finding these two mean proportionals geometrically. I will post the mathematics of Hippocrates' findings on my website at mathsciencehistory.com so that you can have a visual if you're interested. According to the ancient historian Eratosthenes, while Plato was in Sicily, he had proposed this math puzzle of doubling the cube to the citizens of Delia. That is why the doubling of the cube problem is often referred to as the Delian problem. For Plato, as a philosopher, his goal was to introduce the Delians to geometry and provide them with a unique and different way of looking at mathematics. Plato's new friend, Archytas, was also contemplating this same puzzle. However, Archytas had a different approach. Archytas utilized theories of proportions and empirical observations. Thus, instead of thinking through the problem, Archytas constructed the problem and the solution using solids. Archytas's technique was groundbreaking because all other methods up to this point were applied using only two-dimensional geometry. Using three-dimensional geometry, Archytas intersected a quarter of a cone, a cylinder, and a section of a torus. It was brilliant and provided a new way of understanding mathematics. There is a phenomenal website called takaiwamoto.com that provides AutoCAD instructions on how to recreate Archytas' model of this solution. You will also be able to find the link to takaiwamoto.com on my website at mathsciencehistory.com. Archytas applied a mechanical approach to his mathematics, which did not bode well with Plato. According to Eratosthenes, Plato reproached Archytas for resolving the problem of duplication of volume by using tangible solids. He called it, quote, irrational. Eratosthenes states, quote, "They resorted to a method that was irrational. In proceeding in this way, did not one lose irredeemably the best of geometry by a regression to a level of the senses which prevents one from creating and even perceiving the eternal and incorporeal images among which God is eternally God?" In other words, Plato believed that mathematics must be imagined and perceived. In contrast, Archytas believed that understanding mathematics sometimes requires a mechanical process. Nevertheless, they agreed to disagree and remained friends. While traveling in South Italy, Plato traveled to Syracuse. There he met a philosopher named Dion, who was the brother-in-law of Dionysus I. Dion and Plato became close friends. As a result, Plato found himself involved in a family dispute. Around 390 BCE, Archytas asked Plato to serve as a teacher and philosopher to Dionysus I. Up until this point, Plato often entertained the idea of being a political leader. Plato believed that kings could be made into philosophers, and that philosophers could be made into kings, and that there could be an ideal philosopher-king. Dionysus and his family were a rather violent and paranoid group. Dionysus was so paranoid that someone would murder him. He forced his visitors, even his son, to strip down to show that they were completely unarmed. Dionysus then made them change into different clothing. Dionysus was so violent that he even killed a man who dreamt of killing Dionysus. Upon arriving, Plato was shocked by the Syracusan lifestyle. Plato, years later, wrote, "And when I came, I was in no way pleased at all with the, quote, blissful life. One's existence is spent gorging food twice a day and never sleeping alone at night, and all the practices which accompany this mode of living." Plato informed Dionysus that no person can become wise if he is focused on gluttonous behavior. This advice did not go over well with the elder Dionysus. As a result, Dionysus became angry with the philosopher and sold Plato into slavery. Luckily for Plato, a friend and philosopher, Anaxarchus, paid for Plato's freedom and sent him back to Athens. It was a narrow escape for Plato. Back in Athens, Plato succeeded as a philosopher. And during this time, he founded the Academy, where he produced his works, Republic, and the Symposium. While Plato was in Athens, Dionysus had died, either by alcohol poisoning or, possibly, by a sleeping potion given to him by his own son, Dionysus II. At the urging of Dion and possibly Archytas, Plato agreed to work with the family again. This time, it was Dionysus II that Plato tried to turn into a philosopher. So, at the age of 60, he traveled again to Syracuse, stating, quote, "I ultimately incline to the view that if we were ever to attempt to realize our theories concerning laws and government, now is the time to undertake it," unquote. Plato began to make an impression on Dionysus II. However, the younger Dionysus was surrounded by sycophants who were concerned with Plato's persuasive methods. As a result, they started to inform Dionysus II that Dion was using Plato to convince the younger Dionysus to step down from power. The lackeys were successful. After 4 months of trying to work with Dionysus II, Plato was unable to make him a philosopher. Instead, the younger Dionysus charged Dion with tyranny and exiled him from Syracuse. Plato's work was done, and he returned to Athens again. Then, several years later, Archytas reached out to Plato, urging him to go back to Syracuse to try and work with Dionysus II again. Though Plato was 70 years old, he held steadfast to his philosophical beliefs and went to Syracuse. However, though his efforts were partially successful, Dionysus II could never prove himself a true philosopher. He plagiarized other philosophers, and he misunderstood Plato. He regurgitated what Plato had taught him without any thoughts or revelations of his own. According to Plato, Dionysus' efforts were simply a means to gain more power. During their teachings, the younger Dionysus tried to use Plato as a tool to strip Dion of his property and earnings. This manipulation did not bode well for Plato, and he would not go along with Dionysus' plot. As a result, Dionysus II banned Plato from the palace and sent him to live in the Gardens Lodge. Dionysus II instructed his guard to watch over Plato and not let him ever leave Syracuse. While trapped in the servants' quarters, too much time had passed for Plato to escape. All of the trading ships departed Syracuse. Plato had no way off the island. While living in the servants' quarters, he communicated with mercenaries from Athens paid to fight Dionysus's war. Some of these mercenaries informed him that the people he was living among were plotting his murder. Plato, worried about his demise, arranged to have a messenger send a letter to Archytas in Tarentum. Luckily, the message got to Archytas. Archytas, realizing the danger that his friend was in, arranged for a ship to go to Syracuse and rescue Plato from Syracuse. Plato returned safely back to Athens, where he lived to the age of 80. Even though they agreed to disagree, and even though they had differing views on mathematics, Plato had a deep respect for Archytas. Some scholars theorize that in Plato's work, Republic, the rulers he refers to are Archytas and Dionysus. In a sense, Republic is his way of honoring his friend Archytas. In Republic, Plato, without naming names, questions how society creates rulers who are tyrants, much like Dionysus, and rulers who are conscientious philosophers, like Archytas. Possibly, Plato even considered Archytas as the ideal philosopher king, which for Archytas is the highest compliment this profound philosopher could endow. And such is the relationship between two peers, two reliable friends, and two successful men who could truly count on each other. Thank you for joining me at Math Science History. Please remember to subscribe to the show. Also, if you could leave a rating or a review, it would be so appreciated. Those ratings and reviews really help to increase my listenership, which helped me to get more sponsors, which helped me to keep the podcast up and running. If you want to learn more about the history of math and science, please visit me at mathsciencehistory.com. And if you like what you're listening to, please feel free to click on that cup of coffee image and buy me a cup of coffee or two. two or three or four. Because every cup of coffee that you buy helps me to pay for the expenses that go into making this podcast. Also, if you're interested in leaving me a comment or chatting with me, you can always find me on your preferred social media platform, including Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, LinkedIn, and Goodreads. Just search for Gabrielle Burchak. Until next time, carpe diem.